Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to give my short talk. Unlike most of the previous presenters, I will be speaking from the bioarchaeologist's point of view, so we can have more. So we'll be represented from both sides. And unlike previous presentations, mine is going to be more light. It's not going to contain any mathematical formulas, any complicated texts. So basically, for the very introduction, what is bioarchaeology? I presume most of you know. Basically, bioarchaeology is analysis of human biological remains from archaeological contexts. In broadest sentence, it's a reconstruction of individuals' biological but also cultural and social aspects, such as sex, age, and death, occupation, habitual activities, cause of death, diet, and so on. In this type of research, we use both microscopic and microscopic approach, and we use identical methodologies, forensic anthropology. Of course, as I've mentioned, bioarchaeologists, we are not alone. In our studies, we don't use bioarchaeology as such, but we combine it with obviously archaeology, historic sources, art history, but also with state-of-the-art approaches such as radiological, molecular, biochemical methods. In short, we use holistic approach with the aim to reconstruct past humans in their broadest biological, cultural, and social context. When I mentioned forensic anthropologists, this is the slide that I like to use. Presume most of you have seen CSI Miami, Bones.
So basically, these very popular TV shows. In these very popular TV shows, these scientists, they use the same methods and
techniques that we use in our bioarchaeological studies. So, why do we like to use paleoradiology in our bioarchaeological analysis? First, paleoradiology identifies lesions or objects that are not seen by the naked eye. And in later slides, I will give you examples for each of these. Postulates here. Second, it allows development of new techniques and protocols for non-destructive analysis and microexcavation, something that Mislav already showed us in his previous presentation. Then it reconstructs certain morphological and physical features, again seen from Mislav's, but you will see also from my presentations based on Fabio's work. It also supplements paleoradiological images, supplement conventional bioarchaeological data, and these are very important, especially in scientific publications. We who work in research institutes, we know that we have to publish. There's a saying, publish or perish. So we have to publish as much as we can. Basically, our salary depends on this. And finally, it allows a better and more visible dissemination and communication of our results. Again, an issue that was already mentioned by Mislav. Okay. And finally, paleoradiologists are funny and like to party. So this is just one of them. Okay, let's get a bit more serious. As I mentioned, I will just show you for each of these statements that I've mentioned on the slide before. I want to show you just a couple of examples, recent examples that have been published or still some unpublished cases. The first case comes from the early Neolithic impresocardium site of Smilčić near Zadar in Dalmatia. It was excavated, as you may see. Basically, this is an early Neolithic site of Smilčić impresocardium site that was excavated 4 years ago. This is a typical early Neolithic burial. This is an adult male. With an object that was embedded in his left posterior femur. So when my PhD student Mario was analyzing the skeleton, he asked me, "Oh, look, we have some kind of object embedded in the femur." And my first impression and my first answer to him, "Just take it out. It's something post depositional. It's nothing special." But then our colleague Ivor Jankovic said, "Wait a minute. We should take this and make a CT scan with Mislav and see maybe it's something else." And actually it turned out to be quite something else. As you may see here on these CT scans, this is basically a stone that was embedded into the posterior femur about 2.5 centimeters deep. And as you can see here, there is a still slight osteogenic reaction, basically meaning that the bone started to heal. So this we presume it was a point of a spear tip or something similar that was stuck in this individual's posterior side, let's say so. He didn't die straight away after after he was pierced with this probably spear, but we presume he died several days or several weeks after. Most probably out of poisoning, blood poisoning or something, some other complications. So this is just one of the examples how paleoradiology can reveal certain aspects that are not immediately seen by the naked eye. A second case also was published last year with in our collaboration with Mislav and Patrick Eppenberger and other friends from Zurich. This is a case of Bedara cave located in Jumberak Hills in northwestern Croatia, dated to about the middle fourth millennium BCE, middle in Neolithic. Basically, as you can see from this example, this is the osteologist, the speleologists found this specimen and they took it out. And basically, as you can see morphologically, it resembles it's a proximal femur enclosed in a thick layer of skeletonic calcite deposits. And on a first view, we thought we were looking at it. It resembles a human femur. However, we didn't want to. As you can see here, there is a bone fragment. There is a bone still visible underneath this skeletonic deposit. It's about 0.5 centimeter thick. So when I mentioned that there was a paleoradiology helps us to develop new protocols and strategies for non-invasive analysis, this is what we've done. So basically, we virtually cleaned this whole speleotemic calcite and basically we got morphologically completely basically new bone. And we managed to measure the bone, and then our zooarchaeologists checked the bone. It wasn't a human bone; it was a deer bone, if I'm not so as a pig bone. Excuse me, it was a pig femur. But as you can see, when you look at it, it very closely resembles to a human femur. And the last example I want to show you today, Mislav already showed it. This is a osteochondroma, which is basically a benign bone tumor from the late medieval site of Ilok in eastern Croatia. As you can see here, Mislav already showed it. It's about 5 centimeters in diameter. It has a cauliflower shape. So it's on the proximal fibula, excuse me, of this individual. So as you can see, basically this individual had a very, very large bony growth in his lower leg. So what we did, we x-rayed it, took a CT scan, micro CT scan and CD guided autopsy, biopsy and pathohistology. Mislav already showed. So just an example of x-ray, micro CT and pathohistology. And we managed to confirm that it was really an osteochondroma with doing a minimum amount of damage. Then again, on the other hand, paleoradiology helps us to bring the dead people to life. Basically, we can do facial reconstructions of individuals from our ancient past. So I presume Fabio still remembers this. It was three or four years ago. This is CT scanning at his former workplace, research unit of paleoradiology and allied sciences in Ospedale Maggiore in Trieste. Fabio and his team doing a CT scan of one now it's famous noble woman from Croatia that we know even by her name, and then where she died, how she died, and a lot of historiographical data. So we're taking a CT scan here and CT scan of a skull. So we found out a lot of information about this individual. And if you remember, Fabio mentioned Fabio mentioned that he, when he was talking about his analysis of femurs, about the family Di Prata from Pordenone, this individual, she's known as Sofia Castellancic Di Prata. Basically, she's part of the family that moved at the end of the 14th century from Pordenone, when Pordenone was occupied by Venice, to Croatia, Croatian-Hungarian kingdom at the time, and she was married for one of the viceroys of Croatia. So this is really high social status. And we know where she died. Her grave was excavated. Her burial was excavated a few years ago by Croatian Conservation Institute. And we were lucky that we had Fabio, and he managed to give us to put a face on this individual. So basically, this is the first individual from Croatian Middle Ages that we know by name and that we have facial reconstruction made of. And this is very, very recent. We had archaeological excavations at the island of Far, town of Far, this spring and summer, and they excavated about 25-30 late antique burials, and we were lucky that there were a lot of preserved skulls. So for the exhibition that I will show you just a bit later, Fabio made a few facial reconstructions. So this is an unknown adult male from 4th to 5th century Far. So this is basically what paleoradiology does for us. It brings to life hundreds of years old people. So in more scientific terms, and especially in scientific publications, paleoradiological imaging complements conventional bioarchaeological, but also other archaeological data. And we have much higher chance of publication if all these information are joined together. This is just one example of our, this is a artificial deformed crania from the site of Osijek in Eastern Croatia from the Great Migration period dated to the 5th century CE that was published 2 years ago in PLOS One. And I think since then we have about 30,000 downloads of this paper. And a lot of it's owning to Mislav's CT scans of this skull. And obviously my research team has over a dozen high quality research papers in the last 10 years. And these are just some examples. Most of these paleoradiological imaging is the basis of these papers. So just a couple of examples. And last but not least, already we mentioned dissemination communication of our information and data to a general audience, to wider public. And we are luckily we are in the museum, archaeological museum here in Pula. And the basic point of existence of museums is to present the data that we get during our excavations to the general public. Per se, paleoradiological data is primarily visual, and this attracts general audience. And this makes it perfect for museum exhibitions because it adds inter and multidisciplinary character to our events and activities. And this is just one very recent example from the archaeological park in Jovia Ludbreg, which is close to Zagreb in northern Croatia. This is the one dates from the May 2021, so half a year ago when it was opened. And this is a reconstruction of a Ostrogothic 5th century burial that was found. This in the individual was buried basically on Roman terme. You can see this is a reconstruction of his burial, Roman tegule. And Fabio was also kind enough to make a facial reconstruction of this individual. So basically we know how this individual looked in life, but also how this individual looked in death. So basically, as I've already mentioned, paleoradiology animates dead objects and people. But the last thing I wanted to mention in this context, our try to make our information and data more close to a general audience is an exhibition that was opened a month ago in Trieste. So I would urge all of you, if you are in, if you can, to visit the exhibition, Volti dalla storia, una mostra in materiale. It's an exhibition in the Museo d'Antichità J.J. Winkelmann. I don't know what is it, how is it pronounced in Italian. The exhibition is open until the beginning of the next year. Basically, it's based on the facial reconstructions of various people from prehistory to the late Middle Ages. And it has, I'm going to go a bit local here, it has a lot of facial reconstructions of individuals from the territory of Croatia. So I hope that we will see this exhibition. It's really nice, small exhibition that we'll see it, soon in one of the Croatian archaeological museums. And when I was talking about Sofia Kaštelančić di Prata, so basically this is one part of the exhibition that was dedicated to her. We scanned the whole skeleton, and this is basically the her face during the facial reconstruction. She was trademarked. She's the trademark of this exhibition. This is a part dedicated to her. So we have completely reconstructed the whole body. Fabio and his colleagues, they put on some high nobility costumes and clothes of the time. So we have completely reconstruction how she looked. These are facial reconstructions. Unfortunately, the picture is not the best of her ancestors, the Prata family. So we can compare compare their faces. But also, as I mentioned, Fabio printed. He has 3D prints of her complete skeletons, and he also completely reconstructed her burial. So we basically have most of the aspects of her life and death in one place. And I think this is an excellent indicator and shows how we can present our data that, let's face it, very often they are quite dry and boring. They are not boring to the five of us who are dealing with this topic, but this is a very good example how we can make it much more interesting and closer our information to the general public. And what should we say at the end? Basically, I think there are mutual benefits for both bioarchaeologists and archaeologists and paleoradiologists, because paleoradiology adds added value to a standard archaeological but also bioarchaeological studies. It significantly improves our research, publication, and dissemination activities and efforts. And it makes ancient people and artifacts more alive and much closer to the general audience. And I think this is the point of why we are doing this. We are not doing this because of ourselves, and we cannot forget that basically we are paid by this audience and we have to give something in return. So thank you very much.
So thank you, Mario. You have wonderful city images. but these are the cases where we can observe that paleoradiology is not just another feature for publication, but it adds some clinical value in the story, in the question of paleopathologists. Maybe this last slide that we saw indicates the future of radiology. Maybe we are all moving towards 3D printing. What do you think about it?
Definitely. Last year we opened a new laboratory for bioarchaeology at our institute, and we got 3D scanner, 3D printer. So we are start printing not just archaeological artifacts, but also bones and some kind of pathologies that are prone to destruction, so we can preserve them. Or we can even, they can be made as some kind of, not souvenirs, but for teaching material, or we can store them in visual repositories. So definitely yes, because it gets harder and harder to obtain osteological material. Fortunately, in Europe, we still don't have this problem, but in the United States, in North America in general, with their politics of returning osteological remains to the native people, they have huge problems of analyzing anything that's older than the 19th century. So I think everything will go towards the 3D printing and non-destructive analysis.
We hope Illyrians and historians won't pass this law.
Hopefully not.